So we will have a running example of how the Tomasolo's algorithm works. So whenever we do something kind of to explain it, we will also show how it works. So this is an example of how the issue is working. First, this is going to be our issue queue. I'm showing four instructions here. This is the first instruction. This is the second one, third one, and so on. So we will issue in program order, which means the first instruction that we're going to be issue is going to be this F2 equals F4 plus F1. This is really an add, but I'm writing it this way because it's more compact. Next, for each of the floating point registers, which we are going to name F1, F2, F3, and F4, there is a register alias table, or RAT, where we're going to keep which instruction is supposed to produce that register. If there is nothing here, that actually points to the register file. So pretty much if there is nothing here in F1, that's going to mean that you can just find the value for F1 in the actual F1 in the register file. This is our register file. We have four registers, and these are their actual values. When we go through the example, we will actually compute with them. So again, this is the register file. Again, the RAT, when it's empty, says that basically this means with F1, can just be read from the register file. You don't have to wait for anything. And finally, we're going to have our reservation stations. We're going to name them RS1, 2, 3 for the add reservation stations and 4 and 5 for the multiplication reservation stations. So we really have five reservation stations, but note that you can use only these three for adds and only these three for multiplies divides. Now we are ready to actually issue an instruction. So again, this is going to be the first one we issue. The first step is to take it from the instruction buffer. The next step is to look at the RAT and find whether our inputs are ready or not. And in this case, both of the inputs are ready. F1 and F4 are both available. So we're gonna say that this is an add. And we're gonna take the value for, in this case, F4 and F1, and that's gonna be 0.71, and it's gonna be 3.14. And place the instruction in the reservation station. Of course, that assumes that there is a reservation station available. We will see eventually what happens when there isn't any. And the final step for register renaming is to say that the result of the instruction F2 is going to come from now on from reservation station 1. So here we will write RS1. So future instructions that want F2 are not going to read -1. They're going to wait for this result to be produced. So this is the renaming of the very first instruction. One final step that we will do, of course, is remove this instruction from the issue queue. And what's going to happen now is this is going to shift down. But for my example, that's going to be very difficult to do. So I'm just going to kind of cross out this instruction. So this just means that, you know, this instruction has been removed from the issue queue. To make things more interesting for remaining instructions and also to see what happens when an instruction is renamed, let's issue one or two more instructions. So let's issue the next instruction, which is this one. This is a divide. We need to find a free reservation station here. Say it's a divide. F2 and F3 are going to be the parameters for this instruction. F2 comes from RS1, so we cannot simply read this value here. We're going to say here that RS1 is what we are waiting for, but F3 is available, so we're going to get 2.72 from the register file. And we're going to now mark this instruction as, we're going to basically take it out of the issue queue, and this is so very easy to forget, but when we do that, we need to mark that the result, the F1, is from now on not going to be coming from here, it's going to be coming from reservation station 4. And we're going to issue this instruction too. It's a subtraction, so it's going to go here. F1 and F2 are the parameters. We see that neither of those two can be read from the register file. So what we're going to do is we're going to mark here that the first parameter is going to be produced by RS4. The second one is going to be produced by RS1. We're going to then mark that F4 is coming from RS2. And we're going to remove this instruction from the issue queue. Of course, more instructions are probably going to come this way, but we're not going to look at that because, again, that would be too many instructions for this example. Now, let's say that there wasn't an issue slot here. We then couldn't issue the next instruction in the next cycle until we are actually done executing one of these two. I'm not going to do that, but just keep in mind that when you want to issue an instruction, you first have to check whether a reservation station is available. If not, then we simply cannot issue that instruction. let's issue it now because we do have room for it. It's an addition of F2 and F3. F2 comes from reservation station 1. F3 comes from the register file. So we're just going to take the 2.72. We're going to then rename F1 to point to this result. And now we see that F1 is already renamed to reservation station 4. That's basically, if you want to use F1, since this instruction, you would be waiting for its result. But now, F1 is being basically renamed to another reservation station. So this is how register renaming here works in Tomasulo's algorithm. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically override this with the name of this reservation station, which is RS3. And now we have issued all of our 4 instructions. In a real processor, you would issue 1 instruction each cycle, and probably some of these instructions would have executed by the time we issue all of them, but I just wanted to show you how issue works if, for example, nothing could execute for some reason. Now that we have gone through an example of issuing, let's see what the next step is.